Lead me to a rock. He's talking to the Lord that is higher than I. He was a person. He was a man of prayer. Hannah was a woman of prayer. Her desire was to have a child, and she was barren. And every day she would go to the temple, and she would not audibly pray, but she would just move her mouth to the point where the priest thought that perhaps she was inebriated. But she was a woman of prayer. God answered her prayer and gave her Samuel. And she promised the Lord, if you give me a child, I'll give him back to you. She gave him the prophet Samuel. And when Samuel grew up and became weaned from breastfeeding, she took him down to the temple and left him there with the old man Eli. And the scripture says every year she would come and measure little Samuel and make him a brand new robe so that he could minister into the presence of the Lord. Prayer has always been important in the lives of God's people. And even as we get to the New Testament, even though Jesus was the Son of the living God, he modeled prayer. He slipped away from the crowd and oftentimes spent time alone with God. He prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane. He prayed when it was time to raise Lazarus from the dead. He prayed when they put two fish and five loaves of bread in his hand. He modeled prayer. And so now Paul, when he finally finds out who Jesus is and has been changed from Saul to Paul, he also experiences the discipline of prayer. Paul is a prayer. He prays. He believes in the power a prayer, and oftentimes he greets the churches by saying, I remember you in my prayers. Remember you in my prayers. He was a man of prayer, and last night he gave us instructions when he said, be anxious for nothing, but in everything through prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known unto God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. And it is Paul who tells us to pray about everything, and in everything give thanks. This is the will of God concerning you in Christ Jesus. James says, if you've got issues between yourselves and your brothers, confess your faults one to another and pray one for another, that you might be healed. For the effectual fervent prayer of the righteous avails much. I grew up in a household of prayer. My mother was a prayer. She believed in prayer. And I've been taught all my life that prayer changes things. Prayer changes things, and I believe in the power of prayer. I'm here because somebody prayed. Amen, amen. I'm well because somebody prayed. I have an insurance card in my pocket. If anything happens to me, I go to the hospital and pull out my insurance card. But there was a time when we didn't have HMOs, and we didn't have health care plans, and Obamacare, and nobody else's care. And there are times when Viva was in my body, and my mother had an eighth grade education and my father had a third grade education, and she would rub me down with some homemade salve. And she would go out in the back. I'm from South Jersey, where it gets the tag Garden State. I'm from way down south near the Delaware Memorial Bridge, where it really is country. And she would go out in the backyard and pull up an onion out of the garden and cut it in half, and she would put it under my armpits and put the other half under the ball of my feet and wrap me up with clothes. And then she would take Vicks Vapor Rub and she would rub it on my chest and rub it right here just below my nose. And then she would stick her finger in it and she would say, open your mouth. Biggest day on the bottle, it says, do not swallow. She would say, open your mouth. She put her finger in my mouth with that Vicks on it, and she said, now swallow it. And if Vicks could kill you, I should have been dead by now. I've swallowed enough Vicks in my life. But then she would pray over me. And she would say, Father, in the name of Jesus, I need you to rebuke this fever. Now, we all educated, we know the word is rebuke. But I'm so glad that faith can work even with Ebonics. That even if you don't know how to properly pronounce the word, the God we serve who understands the thoughts before they become words can still hear and answer prayer. He can answer prayer. He's a prayer answering God. When I went away to college, I remember standing in my living room, and I was headed to Dallas, Texas, where I first started my college career, and my mother didn't have any money to give me. She couldn't pay my way. And she didn't even go to the airport. She just stood in the middle of her living room, and she held hands with my brothers and sisters who were going to take me to the airport. And she began to pray, and she said, Lord, I've done the best I could. I raised him best I know how. And you let me live long enough to see him graduate high school. Now he's on his way to college. I don't have any money to send with him. I can't pay for college, but you opened the door. You made a way for him to go. And Lord, I'm putting him in your hands. She said, now put some angels along the side of that airplane and take him safely to Dallas. I don't know anybody in Dallas, but you know people in Dallas. Lord, put somebody in his path and cover him and make a way for him. She didn't have money to give me, but she gave me something much more valuable than that. Come on, she sent me out covered in prayer. And I can tell you from that day to this day, God is still blessing me. Here in the text, we find Paul and Silas in a situation that seems to be unfair, for they find themselves in jail for preaching God's word. You would think that they would be angry, upset, and complaining. They did nothing wrong and was arrested because of preaching God's word. They were arrested because they were filled with the Holy Spirit. And when this young girl that was demon-possessed kept interrupting the service, Paul cast that devil out of her. She had the ability to tell the fortunes or futures. And when her owners realized they've lost their money-making game, they had Paul and Silas arrested, whipped and beaten and put in the inner prison. But the Bible says around midnight, Paul and Silas began to pray and sing praises unto the Lord. You see, it's interesting that when you read the book of Acts, when you get to up to chapter 15, is Paul and Barnabas. But there was a dissension between Paul and Barnabas over John Mark. And Mark wanted to go with them on their next missionary journey. And Paul wouldn't allow it because he had abandoned them early on. Paul said, it's rough out here and we don't need cowards on the journey. He left us before, we can't take that chance. And Barnabas, being the gentleman that he was, said, yes, but everybody needs some grace. And they went back and forth, and the Bible says the dissension grew so sharp between Paul and Barnabas that they parted ways. Barnabas took Mark, and Paul took Silas. And here we have in Acts chapter 16, is Paul and Silas. They prayed, and the prisoners heard them. You see, I like that because instead of complaining, they went into worship. They teach us how to handle our trouble. They prayed about it. And the word of God says somehow between prayer and praise, the Lord started moving. Listen, if you want to get God's attention, you don't get his attention by having a pity party. You don't get his attention by complaining. You don't get his attention by murmuring. But if you want to get God's attention, go into prayer or go into praise. Do I have a witness in the house? Listen, the word of God says they prayed and they praised, and the prisoners heard them. That allows me to know that sometimes what we go through is not just for us, but it's for the folk that are around us. Y'all hear me here? The word says after they prayed and praised, suddenly the jail started to shaking. Shake from the bottom up, and the doors and the gates swung open, and everybody's bands were loosed. That blows my mind. Two people prayed, but all the gates swung open, and everybody's bands were loosed. You'll get it in a minute. Just two people prayed, but all the gates swung open, and everybody's bands were loose. Do you know that sitting on your row could be somebody that's bound? But if you pray, then you could be the catalyst to bring deliverance to your whole row. That's why when you come to worship on any night or any Sunday morning, you ought to come with a mind that if nobody else gives God glory, I'm going to give him praise. Nobody else clapped their hand, I'm going to clap my hand. If nobody else says hallelujah, I'm going to lift him up anyhow. Because there could be some other prisoners sitting around you. And oftentimes also lets me know that people are watching how you handle your situations. You think you're the only one going through a troubled marriage? You think your children are the only one wilding out? You think you're the only one having trouble on your job? Usually when you go through something, God places you in an atmosphere where others are going through the same thing. Watch this. And they need to know what God's work looks like. So he will let you go through your trouble right in plain sight. He won't hide you. Your stuff is out in the public. But I tell you what, because you remain steadfast and unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, that when the Lord begins to bless you and bring you out, it shows others what will happen if they put their trust in the Lord. Or do I have a witness in that? They're watching you because they need to know what it looks. They need to know what more than a conqueror looks like. Come on, they need to know what a hallelujah praise looks like. They need to know what victory looks like. Listen, victory doesn't, you don't see victory because people don't go through something. Victory looks good when it goes through the water, but come out not drowning. Victory looks good when it goes through the fire, but it come out unscathed. Yeah, Paul and Silas prayed and the prisoners heard them. And everybody's bands were loosed. Everybody got delivered. That's why there's no room for jealousy in the house of God. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. You got to believe that when the Lord blesses over here, he's able to bless over there too. Come on, somebody. There's no secret what God can do. Do I have a witness in the house? Paul and Silas begin to pray, and I guarantee that when you go through whatever you're going through, get yourself a prayer. Don't have to be a long prayer, but just talk to the Lord. And then back it up with praise. Because when you praise God, you're saying, I've got confidence that you're able. I know he's able. And amen. I've learned how to praise him in the midst of my trouble. Praise him in the midst of my storm. Praise him when I feel like it, and praise him when I don't feel like it. Praise shifts the atmosphere. Praise gets God's attention. Instead of murmuring and complaining, touch and agree. And start praying and praise. And between one of the two, God's going to show up. Do I have any help in the house? When the doors open, I love it. Everybody was set free. Yeah, you can come in bound and leave lifted if just two or three will go ahead and praise him. That's why when the choir started singing, I had to get up. When the praise goes up, I got to get up. I feel down, but I hear somebody say, thank you, Jesus. And it makes me feel a little bit better. I hear somebody say, for every mountain. And I start thinking about the mountain over here and the mountain over there and the mountain over here and the mountain over there. And how every valley, I start seeing that one, this one, and I got to give him some praise. Let me ask you, has God done something for you lately? Has he blessed you lately? Has he brought you through lately? Has he brought you out lately? Then you ought to give him praise. Has he turned it around for you? Has he made a way for you? You ought to give him praise. Then don't look like you're defeated, but you ought to look like you're in the name of Jesus. You still have the victory, because he's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. I know this is Messiah Baptist Church, but I'm going to tell you, praise has no denomination. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's a liberty. And I found out when praises go up, blessings will come down. And guess what? Even when you don't praise him, he's still blessing you. Do I have a witness? How blessed are you? Blessed coming in. Blessed going out. Blessed in the city. Blessed in the field. Blessed in the morning. Blessed in the evening. When I'm walking, I'm blessed. When I'm talking, I'm blessed. When I'm catching the bus, I'm blessed. Every time you see me, I'm blessed. In fact, every time I turn around, he's blessing me. Do I have a witness in the house? Prayer changes things. Praise changes things. Paul said, you pray and I'll praise. I sing and you pray. But we're not going to let this situation get us down. We're under some pressure right now. But we're turning our pressure into praise. Are you going through anything tonight? I dare you. Get yourself a praise. Say hallelujah. Anyhow. Hallelujah. Anyhow. Hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. Shout glory. Let the devil know. Listen, I love this. I heard a quartet sing this song. And the words are these. And I want you to tell somebody these words. Say, neighbor. I've seen too much victory to let defeat have the last say. Has anybody seen too much victory? Then you ought to praise him and not let the devil have the last say. Because the last time I checked, the word says, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love the Lord and according to his purpose. And I don't know about you, but I praise him that even in my pressure, he's working it out for my good. Now I dare to tell him, thank you. Thank you for what you already done. Thank you for what you're doing right now. Then look ahead and say, thank you for what you're going to do. And turn your pressure into praise.